How did you come about doing this project?
Well, my manager, Joe D'Onofrio, introduced me to you, George, and we tossed about doing a record together. And I was thrilled because you're very supportive of the arts. And we kind of threw a couple things. We were talking Brazilian music for a while. We were doing, you know, just exploring something to do. And then you came up with the record, with the idea of doing Herbie Hancock, which at first I was hesitant because, you know, he's such a giant influence and force on me. I didn't want to, like, try to recreate Herbie Hancock, you know. I think that would have been, you know, a bad mistake for me to do, and I couldn't do it even if I tried, you know. So we talked about tunes. We kind of went over songs, and we chose material, and I went about the task of, you know, trying to flip them. I call it flipping, you know, or mashing them together to kind of fit them into what I do best, or my style. And part of that flipping progress is a process is also choosing musicians, you know, like who I felt, you know, I would really love to play with and who would play this music great, you know. And then we went through and we called these great musicians to work on this record. And
they are
Christian McBride on bass, who can play anything, plays great electric bass, plays acoustic bass, and we've been working together off and on for about 10 years. I've been playing in his bands, and it's a great honor. Actually, we played together even long ago that with Freddie Hubbard, which is one of his first gigs, I guess, in New York when he was around 17. And then Jeff Watts, who I've known for a long time through Kenny Kirkland. And then when Jeff was living out here in L.A. doing the Tonight Show, we had a chance to hang out and become friends and play a little bit. And so he flew out and played great on the record. You know, I can't think of anybody else that I'd rather have.
And then you decided to put Roy Hargrove on some cuts.
And then Roy was in town, you know. We'd hung out in Puerto Rico and in New York a few times and kind of got to know each other a little bit. And Roy happened to be playing at the Bowl the next night, so we grabbed him. He came in and played on three tunes.
Right. So the concept here would be a tribute to Herbie Hancock in the sense that we chose tunes either written by Herbie Hancock or some tunes that you wrote which had some of the feeling of Herbie's writing, would you say?
Right? I would say so.
Periods.
Yeah.
Right. And let's talk about some of the periods that we covered, because obviously Herbie has written across decades, and his style, while he's always kept, I think, the kernel of his style, mm-hmm. he's certainly ventured into other areas. And I think we were trying to get a taste of a number of those areas, right?
Right. Well, the first thing that comes to mind when I think about Herbie Hancock is freedom. And his being such an open book when he plays, and it lets his imagination just go. So we tried to do that on this record, just let the music happen on its own, wherever it went. And, you know, Herbie's such an explorer. So I was able to mash together Maiden Voyage and Tell Me a Bedtime Story, which was kind of an interesting way to do it. And so those are 60s songs, Blue Note era songs. We did Eye of a Hurricane, but with the funky vamp, like which could have come out of the Headhunters period or Sexton period, which is 70s. We did Chan Song from the Midnight, from Round the Midnight soundtrack. But we, you know, I kind of put a different kind of funk meter under it instead of the way he did it. And I actually changed the type signature and a couple little chords. Did a song from the Headhunters era called 4 AM that's like super funky on the record. It's got Jaco Pastorius and Harvey Mason on it. And we did it more of a straight ahead jazz tune. So it was a real pleasure to be able to kind of dissect these tunes and give them another taste of Herbie, I guess.
Right. I noticed one of the things that was really wonderful that you don't always get in a studio is that the three of you, the Colonel, the bass, piano, and drums, when you were playing together, there was such an interplay and such an enjoyment that you did not even really want to stop. I mean, some of the tracks went on for 8 or 9 minutes, and we were just sitting there letting you do your thing because you guys were enjoying it and developing it, and there was a lot of very subtle interplay. And I think that there are moments on this album. I think this album appeals to various types of people who have different what they want out of jazz is different, such as the more simplistic and the more sophisticated. Mm-hmm. And in the sophisticated area, the interplay rhythmically and harmonically that went on is something that people can listen to several times, 3, 4, 5 times to hear a tune, to get all of it. Because it's deceptive. It's not something that you necessarily grab the first time.
Well, I remember, you know, hearing Nefertiti for the first time, and also like, you know, not Heavy Weather, but you know, Mysterious Traveler, or any of those kind of records. So the first time for me, and going, wow, that's cool. I don't know what it is, but it's like falling in love at first sight, and then finding, every time you see her, something else to fall in love about all over again.
Great. So what we have then is a production that I guess you're very proud of. Would you say one of your legacy, something you'd be proud to leave in the world?
Well, I think that's for other people to decide,
right.
Not me.
You feel good about this. You feel
it's been a joy to do it. And it was a really wonderful experience to record it and to play with these great musicians and honor Herbie, you know, who's my hero, you know.
Well, thanks. Is there anything else that you want to add?
Just want to thank you and Ricky and Joe.